Thanks, Rulindra, for the introduction. And actually, good afternoon to you all. And thanks for being here for the integration track. I'm Anupama Patrage from WSO2. And today, in this session, I'm going to talk in detail about how we can handle transactions in microservices architecture. And basically, this is based on a specification that we have developed at WSO2. So I will go through the details of that specification, how we have implemented that specification. And towards the end, I will talk about some of the details of the reference implementation, which is done using Ballerina. So that's a quick overview of my session. So hope you will enjoy this session. Thank you. So before moving to the session, I would like to take you through a simple example that we all are familiar with. Here, Jack is going to transfer £1,000 from his account to Tom's account. So what happens is, when Jack has initiated the transaction, that amount will be debited from Jack's account, and there will be some database updates at his bank. And if that operation is successful, then we are going to credit that amount to Tom's account. So obviously, there will be some database updates at his bank also. If both of these steps are successful, then we say transaction has successfully completed. On the other hand, let's say one of these operations get failed. In that case, we need to revert all the other actions that we have performed, and we say transaction has failed. So this is where the concepts like transactions, transaction boundaries, or XA data sources come into the picture. Before start the session or go into the detail, let's see what is actually a transaction. According to some definition, transaction is an atomic unit of work that should complete in full or not done at all. So during its execution, transaction will go through multiple states. Basically, when it is started, it will be in active state. That's all all of us know already. And in that state, that is where the actual statement processing will happen, like write into a database or write into a message queue, etc. And if all of these operations are successful, then it will go to the partially committed state and eventually to the committed state. So let's say one of these operations got failed during the active state. Then it will go to the failed state. And also, user can abort his transaction. In that case also, it will go to the failed state and eventually to the aborted state. So this is a typical transaction that we already know. Then let's see what is a distributed transaction. This is a typical example of a distributed transaction where we have a message queue, and we are going to remove a message out from that queue, and based on the content of that message, we are going to insert two records into two different databases, which are in two different environments. So we have three data sources here and three resource managers associated with that. So this is a typical example of a distributed transaction, and everything should happen within a single transaction. So that means if any of these steps get failed, let's say write into the second database has failed, in that case, we need to roll back all the other actions that we have performed, and we need to make sure the system is back in the state where it was before the transaction has begun. So only condition here is everything should happen within a single thread of execution. And we need to maintain the same transaction context, which contains the information about this transaction across all these three resource managers. So that is a distributed transaction. Now let's try to see what is the problem that we are trying to solve here. Before that, let's look at what is the different application architectures that we are talking about. The first one is the monolithic application architecture, where we have multiple modules or multiple business components running within the same process. There can be multiple replicas of the same application, but still, within each of these applications, it has multiple modules or business components. As opposed to that, we have microservice architecture. On those kind of applications, we have same business components, but now they are running in different environments as different services. So that is the difference of those two architectures that we studied about on OS. And then let's see how the transaction will work in those two kinds of applications. Here we have a business application which has three components. Let's say it's a vacation planning application, and component one is let's say it's a flight booking application, which is talking to MySQL database. And component two, let's say a hotel booking service, which is talking to Oracle database, likewise. So in that case, if all of these modules are going to participate in the same business transaction, what we need to make sure is we should propagate the same transaction context across all these three components. Since all of them are running in the same process or in the same application, propagating this transaction context is somewhat easy. But on the other hand, when it comes to microservices, still we have the same business components, but now they are running as different services. So requirement is we need to maintain the same transaction context, but the challenge here is we need to propagate it most probably across the network. So that is the problem that we are trying to solve. In practical scenarios, this problem can be really complex. This is an example where microservice 1 is talking to 2 and 3, and 2 is again talking to 4, 4 is talking to 5 and 6. So all these 6 services are participating in the same business transaction, and we need to make sure at the end of all the business interactions, it will come to the conclusion whether to abort the transaction or commit the transaction. So that outcome we refer to as the joint outcome. To come into that joint outcome after the business execution, there are several methodologies. The first one is the joint outcome based on an orchestrator, and the second one is joint outcome based on an coordinator. So let's see what are they. The first one is joint outcome based on an orchestrator. Here we have introduced a central process called orchestrator, and we instrument that orchestrator to handle this transaction. So basically, we instrument it with the required flow of the transaction, flow of the communication, and order of the communication, and maybe some other non-functional properties that we need to maintain during the transaction, likewise. So that orchestrator will talk to all these services and take care of the transaction. So, but here we are going against a basic principle of microservices architecture, that is smart endpoints and dumb pipes, because we have now moved away the smartness away from these microservices, and we have introduced a pipe or a messaging system which is not dumb. So this is not the ideal solution, and the better solution would be the joint outcome based on an coordinator or coordination. So the specification that I told earlier is basically all about this methodology. And first of all, I will go through some key concepts of this specification. And later on, I will describe how anyone can implement this specification. And towards the latter part, I will go through some details about our reference implementation, which is done using Ballerina language, a cloud-native programming language developed at WSO2. So here we have the same 6 microservices that I have showed earlier, and let's see what is called sphere of control. So let's see, the microservice 1 is going to start a transaction. So initially, it will create its own sphere of control, which will contain that microservice only. And now it is going to talk to 2 and 3, that means beyond the created sphere of control. After that, it will have an expanding sphere of control, which is called S2, which include all the 3 microservices. And likewise, when microservice 2 is talking to 3, now we have an even bigger sphere of control, which include all 4 services. And finally, we have a complete sphere of control, which include all the 6 microservices. Now we have an initiator and a set of participants which are participating in this transaction. This process, or this sphere of control, is used to tying all these microservices together as a single unit. That is the key requirement of any transaction. Let's see how we can achieve this, actually. So this is achieved using a process called infection. Let's see how that works. Within each of these microservices, we have a special component called coordination component. And depending on which microservice is initiating the transaction, the coordination component of that service will become the coordinator for the entire transaction. So unlike in the previous case, we don't have a central coordinator like orchestrator, but the coordinator will vary time to time depending on who is initiating the transaction. So microservice 1 is going to initiate the transaction in this example, and it will talk to its own coordinator to start the transaction. and it will return a transaction context. This is the transaction context that we need to maintain, and it will contain the information like global unique identifier for this transaction, and where the other participants come and register, that is the coordinator's registration URL, things like that. So now microservice one is having this transaction context. Now it is going to talk to the microservice two, which is a business call. So along with that business call, it will send this generated transaction context. And when microservice two has received this, it will analyze that context and it will find where the coordinator is, because within the context we have the registration URL. So first thing microservice two will do is it will go ahead and register with the coordinator. And then microservice two is talking to microservice four. So along with that business request, again, this microservice two will send the same context to the service four. Now, service four also analyzed that context and it will go ahead and register with the same coordinator. Likewise, all the six participating microservices go ahead and register with the same coordinator. Now, what we have is we have an initiator, which is microservice one, and coordinator, that is the coordination component of microservice one, and a set of participants or who has registered with this coordinator. So this mechanism is called infection, and the output is the sphere of control. Then, after that initial registration part has completed, each of these microservices will perform their intended business execution. After that, at the end of all of this processing, they need to come together and decide on the joint outcome. That is, whether to commit the transaction or abort the transaction. We call it joint outcome. And there should be a set of negotiation rules to determine this output. What we call that is an agreement protocol. And that agreement protocol basically contains the information exchange between the coordinator and the participants, and also the order of the exchange. Collection of such agreement protocols, we refer to them as a coordination type. Then let's see how this agreement protocol works. First of all, we saw how the registration process works. Then let's see how this agreement protocol is negotiated between all the participating services during the registration process. As I said earlier, when microservice is receiving the context, it will basically contains the global unique identifier for the transaction and also the register at URL, which is the coordinator's registration URL, and the coordination type, that is the coordination type or the protocol supported by the coordinator. And depending on that, this microservice will decide what is the matching protocol that I should use. And after deciding that matching protocol, it will find what are my protocol endpoints or protocol URLs that coordinator can send matching protocol messages to me. So along with this register request, it will send this service's protocol endpoints. So now coordinator knows where I can talk to when I need to send some messages to this microservice. Likewise, as a response to this message, coordinator will send its own protocol endpoints. So now both the coordinator and the microservices, participating services, knows each other what is the protocol that they should negotiate and where they can go to renegotiate that protocol, basically the endpoints. So this is how the protocol establishment works during the registration process. Then, before going to the details, let's see what are these negotiation rules or the coordination types. Basically, we have two coordination types. The first one is two-phase commit coordination based on the popular two-phase commit protocol. And the next one is the compensation coordination. Let's see how this two-phase commit coordination works. Under that, we have three protocols, agreement protocols. The first one is completion protocol. It is used by the participants, which has the ability to control the end of the transaction. That means either by explicitly commit the transaction or aborting the transaction. So initially, the initiator will talk to its coordinator to create the transaction context, and it will return the transaction context. After that, actual business processing will happen. And after some time later, initiator will decide to commit the transaction. So it have to say that to coordinator, and in the background, coordinator has to talk with all the other participants to come into that conclusion. So it has to call the, all the other participants to commit, and if all are agreed to commit, then output will be committed. Then let's say at least one participant has not agreed to commit. Maybe some failure has occurred at that participant. So it will return back saying aborted. And let's say some participant has decided to commit without waiting for coordinator's messages. And another participant at the same time decided to abort. So the outcome may be mixed. That the reason that some participant has decided to commit is sometimes they may have waited so long, so they have unilaterally decided to commit. So those are the three outcomes for this commit message. And the other thing is the abort message. So if let's say the initiator wants to abort the transaction, so it will instruct the coordinator to abort the transaction, and output will be either aborted or mixed. So this is the completion protocol used by the initiator. Next protocol is durable protocol. This is used by the participants which are manipulating persistent data sources like databases. So initially what happens is, let's say initiator has requested a commit, or this is the flow which is triggered by a commit. Then in the background, coordinator has to talk to all of these participants. So it will go ahead and send prepare messages to all the participants, and participant may decide whether I can commit this or abort this. Let's say a participant has successfully completed its business execution, then it will reply with prepared. And sometimes participants are not using or not manipulating any data sources, or it's not writing to any data source. In that case, they are read-only, and they will reply back saying, I'm read-only. So then the coordinator don't need to take into consideration that participant for future processing. So for those two cases, either prepared or read-only means, we can consider those participants as they have voted for commit. And the other case is, let's say that participant got some failure during its execution. Then it will reply with aborted. And sometimes participants don't wait for the messages from coordinator, and they will decide to commit by their own, because maybe they have waited so long from to a message from the coordinator and so on. So they will return as committed. So those are the four outputs for this prepare message. So it is the first phase, that is prepare phase. Then we have the second phase, that is called the commit phase. That means there the coordinator has to analyze all the responses it got from all the participants, and let's say all are agreed to commit. Then coordinator will decide to commit the transaction, and it will notify all the participants to commit, and output will be committed. And on the other case is, at least one participant has decided to abort the transaction. And there we need to abort all the other actions performed by all the participants, and coordinator will send a message to all the participants to abort the transaction, and it will return aborted. So that is the basic flow, and that is why it has two phases, and that is why we are calling this coordination type as two-phase commit coordination. And this is what happened to durable protocol participants by an abort action. Let's say initiator has requested to abort the transaction. In that case, we actually don't need that two phases. We coordinator can directly go to the participants and ask them to abort, and output will be aborted. So that is the second protocol. Next, we have the volatile protocol. That is used by the participants which manipulate volatile data sources such as cache. So earlier I talked about two phases, which is prepare phase and the commit phase. Actually, in prepare phase, we have two stages. In the stage one, it will prepare all volatile participants. That is, sometimes these volatile participants may decide to persist their data during the end of transaction. So we need to give them a chance to persist their volatile data. During that time, that means they cause more durable participant registrations for the same transaction, because it may connect to some other database to persist their data, and that database also will join to the same transaction. So during this phase one, prepare phase, the coordinator will first prepare the volatile participants due to that reason. After that only, coordinator will prepare the durable participants. So that is the only difference between durable and volatile participants. And all the other information flow and order of information exchange is same as the durable participants. So these are the three protocols comes under 2PC coordination. First one is the completion protocol, and then the durable protocol, and finally the volatile protocol. So now let's see the other coordination type, that is compensation coordination. This is used when we cannot apply the normal transaction semantics, like two-phase commit protocol. One scenario is there may be some long-running transactions. In that case, there may be a lot of work which has done during the transaction. We can't just go and revert that. And sometimes it may include some, or it may interact with some non-recoverable data sources or non-transactional data sources, like writing to a file, printing and check, sending an email out, etc. So those kind of scenarios, we can't just use the normal transaction or the normal two-phase commit transactions. There we need to have separate compensation actions to revert the actions performed during the transaction. So this is the compensation coordination type. So that is all about the various theories associated with spec. And now let's see how we can implement this specification. This specification is not bound to any programming language or any underlying protocol like a transport protocol. Anyone can implement this spec. And if they are going to support this spec, there are a few commands and data structures that they need to implement. So let's see what are they. These are the things that I have discussed earlier, actually. The first one is the create new context command. It will send by the initiator to coordinators to start a transaction. The input will be the coordination type supported by this microservice or the initiator, and output will be a data structure called microtransaction context. It should contain the version number, that is the protocol version number, and global unique identifier created for this transaction. And coordination type supported by the coordinator, maybe 2PC or compensation. And finally, the registration URI of the coordinator. That is the URL where other participants come and register. So the second command is the register command, which is used by the participants to go ahead and register with the coordinator. So input for that request is microtransaction registration, the first data structure. It is also contain the same global unique identifier and the protocol supported by this service. And finally, the matching protocol URIs of this service, which needs to instruct the coordinator to in order to send messages to that service. And output for that will be microtransaction coordination struct, which contains the same unique ID and also the matching protocol URI of the coordinator side. So this is the second request. And the next one is the request sent by the initiator to the coordinator. The first one is commit request, which is sent by the initiator to coordinator to commit the entire transaction. And the outcome will be the committed, aborted, or mixed, as I discussed earlier. And also there can be failures. In that case, a fault will return. And similar to commit, we have abort request. It is also sent by initiator to the coordinator, and output will be either a fault message or aborted or mixed. And then we have other commands which are sent by coordinator to the participants. So the first one is prepare request. And in that prepare request also, input is the same global unique ID, and output will be one of these four statuses. And also there can be failures occurs, so the output can be either fault or one of those four status. So then next one is the notify request sent by the coordinator to the participants, either to notify commit or an abort. So that is all about this specification. And let's quickly go through how we have implemented this spec using Ballerina, which is cloud native programming language written by WSO2. So this is a syntax of a Ballerina microservice. So at the top, we have a travel service, which is a microservice. And we have a reserve resource. And I'm not going to talk in detail about this service and resource syntax, but the interesting part here is this transaction block. So having this transaction block means the microservice developer has to put any of the actions they need to perform within the same transactions within this transaction block. So here I have included only one request, which is a GET request. So it is like that microservice 1 is talking to microservice 2. That's a scenario like that. So the interesting part here is the microservice developer don't need to worry anything about the underlying details or all the details that I have mentioned so far. By placing a transaction block means it will automatically handle all this stuff. The transaction block implies that this service will act as an initiator, and the coordination component of this service will become the coordinator for the entire transaction, and a transaction context will be generated, and everything will happen in the background without the microservice developer's interactions. So another thing that I need to highlight here is the retry count. There we can specify number of attempts before aborting the transaction in case of a failure. And before each retry attempt, it will go to the on retry block, where we can place any code block that we need to execute before retry. And also we have committed and aborted blocks, which will execute after the successful or failure scenarios. So let's see how the participant side looks like. This is the participant service. The service and resource syntax is same. But we have a special annotation here that is to indicate that if there are any incoming requests coming in, I have to go ahead and register with that same coordinator. So how that context will arrive to this service, that is a problem. So as you can see here, I am sending a GET request. This is a HTTP service, so I am injecting all these microtransaction context information as HTTP headers to this request. So the participant service will receive them as HTTP headers, and it will analyze them, and it will go ahead and register with the same coordinator. And we have on commit and on abort function pointers here, which will include or which will execute after a successful commit of the transaction or in case of a failure. So that is the ballerina implementation of this specification, which is a reference implementation. And then let's see a practical problem that we may come across with. That is, this is an example where we have a travel management service, and it is written in ballerina, let's say, and it will talk to two other services. One is the airline service, which is also written in ballerina, and the hotel management service, which is written in some other thing, maybe Spring Boot, let's say. So how we can handle a transaction across these type of different environments? That's a problem. So only ballerina knows this specification, and Spring Boot has not implemented this specification, so it cannot participate into this transaction. But to solve that problem, we have a ballerina bridge or ballerina sidecar. This is the component which is get infected via the transaction, and it will pass the messages coming from this transaction coordinators to transaction coordinator to the hotel service, which is a Spring Boot application, which will actually manipulate data in some database. So this ballerina sidecar or ballerina bridge is acting as a bridge between this Spring Boot service and also this ballerina transaction or this transaction implementation. So this is how we can interact with different environments. We also have this ballerina bridge implemented for Spring Boot. So it's a reference implementation that we can look into. And if you are really interested in that, we have separate sessions on this in ballerina track on Thursday. So just participate in that as well. So that's all about this specification and our reference implementation. If you have any questions, this is time to ask.
Check. So we saw that it's a tree that is represented by all the actors, and we clearly identify the first one, the root. How can we know we are on the leaf, which is the last, and how can the coordinator knows that no one is going to register after some commit events, for instance?
Yeah, actually, it's not a tree. It can be any complex interaction. So although it looks like a tree, it's not a tree. So answer to your first question, there is no concept like leaf or something like that. It comes with the order of the registration. Let's say I'm talking to another two microservices, then they will come ahead and register with the coordinator as the second step. And they will again talk to some other three microservices, then they will come and register. So actually we don't need to come into a conclusion of the order. Coordinator doesn't need to maintain the order. But when in the reference implementation, let's say if it has hit the end of the transaction block, that means it has all the participants has registered at that moment, because all the GET request has sent already and everyone has registered with the transaction, and that will imply the end of the transaction. Actually, we don't need to maintain the order. At the end of the transaction, coordinator will go through all the participants and send all the messages.
Have you done any performance tests?
Yeah, actually we have done performance tests for Ballerina, and it will those details are actually in the Ballerina website and with the Ballerina release for transaction TPS and etc. It's there in the website if you can refer the details. But this is actually a reference implementation, so that there may be some improvements, there are some improvements that we can do. So still the work is ongoing. We will do those improvements. We are doing actually those improvements right now.
Do you have any comparative against Saga, for example, the pattern?
You mean the comparative analysis?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, actually we haven't done a comparative analysis for the transaction work itself, but for the entire scenarios, we have done comparative analysis. Also, those details are available in the Ballerina, along with the each Ballerina release. We are releasing Ballerina every month, so those details are available with the each release.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you all for participating for this session.